Coming up on ECG, No Man's Sky.
Legions of Rumors.
No One Can Hide from the Battle Eye.
Anime Godzilla.
All this and more coming up on the East Coast Geek Podcast. Welcome to episode 76 of the East Coast Geek Podcast for Friday, August 14th on, where we bring you all the latest news on comics, movies, and gaming. I'm your host, Jeremy, and with me as always is Opu, even though I almost introduced myself as Opu.
Everybody wants to be the Opu.
Yeah. So, we're back again. It's been a little bit. We've been having some scheduling issues and things going on, personal lives, you know, that kind of stuff. But
I have no life, so. Oh.
Yeah, but you've been working some massive hours.
Yeah, that's true.
I wish my boss would give me some overtime. All right, so what have you been up to, man? What's going on in your life?
Well, I beat GTA 5 finally, man. I regret not having that as a full purchase. That was a game that definitely deserves. That deserves the $60, you know. We always harp on prices and when sales go on, but that was a game that, you know, absolutely deserved it. I feel like, man, that could have been a movie and I would have immediately watched it again if I had the chance.
I will tell you how much it's worth. You want to know how much it's worth?
What?
$180, because I bought it on the 360, the Xbox One, and then on the PC.
Most likely when my PC gets set up, I might buy it again on the PC. I rarely do that. I've only done that with like a handful of games, bought them on separate systems, but I would definitely do that one easily.
You want to see what it looks like on good graphics.
Graphics on everything.
Shots fired already.
The casting was amazing. The voice work. Even, you know, I played several of the GTA games, but I always stopped because you get to that mission where they have bad handling on their vehicles, and you just stop. Like, Vice City was terrible, so I stopped on one of the races or whatever, you know, and the last GTA had that train mission. Everybody remembers that. But this one, with the exception of the helicopter, and I can understand why its controls would kind of suck because it's a helicopter, I was surprised at how well the vehicles controlled. Yeah. Especially if you're using Franklin, because his special ability.
Oh, you bet you use the shit out of that.
Oops. Oh, the best way to use it is not like in long, you know, don't drain the whole thing. Just use it like in spurts, especially when you're doing turns and you don't have to brake for the turns.
Right.
But his is basically a game breaker.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah. The other ones, you don't really have to use them. I forgot about the other two, halfway through the game.
I barely used Trevor's, which was the rage mode, and what, Michael's was, like, slowdown for...
Yeah, his basically was bullet time, so you could pull off headshots. If it's a mission that calls for a bunch of headshots, his is good.
Yeah.
And Trevor's I like to use when I didn't realize I was low on health.
Yeah, but just in
that
case.
It was such a rare thing, because basically the shotgun finishes everything for you. It's got insane range. It pretty much is a one-hit kill for everybody, even if they're wearing armor, depending on where you hit them. It was an absolutely great game. I can't recommend it enough. So that was my big thing the last week or so on my little bit of off time. What about you?
Well, you know, I finally broke down and I bought No Man's Sky. I know I said I probably wasn't going to do it, but I decided... it might be good for my channel. I'll see. Whatever. But I ended up playing... I didn't play it Friday night because we had a party for a friend. Happy birthday, Scott. Scott, who's been on the show before. But I finally got around to playing it starting, I don't know, sometime Saturday afternoon. Since I'm on nights, I sleep in a little and all that good stuff. But I think I put in about 8.5 hours or so on Saturday between three parts that I recorded, which I kind of want to go play a little more. It's a lot more fun than I was expecting, and I don't know, because I was asked, and we'll kind of get into everything else here later, but I was asked if I would recommend it. I said, It really depends on the person. Like, if you play Minecraft or Terraria or anything like that, and you can kind of make your own way and make your own fun, that's going to be more so in Minecraft than Terraria, but that's going to be what you need to do. But even still, I mean, there's so much to do. It reminds me of games like Privateer, which was back on the, you know, back in the early 2000s for computers. It was space trading and combat. The combat's okay, but the trading is awesome because, you know, you got these traders that would show up in a station or at a platform that would pay, like, plus 99% above the current market galactic value. So it's nice to see that kind of thing implemented. It gives you that somewhat randomness, but at the same time, if you're in a system that needs it and can't get it easily, it's kind of one of those things. It's the supply and demand thing. So they have that stuff built in there. The other gameplay aspects are really great, too. But otherwise, between that and banging my head against the frickin' wall with The Witcher 3. So I was streaming last night, and a friend was watching, and he said, "Oh, you don't have such and such sword?" And I was like, "No." And he's like, "Well, it's a silver sword. It'll help you out." So I go get that, and then he's like, "Oh, well, there's some armor you can get back in White Orchard." I was like, I was in White Orchard all of, like, 3 hours and just moved on with the story. I went back and had to go get all kinds of food because I was getting my butt kicked in Velen. So, yeah, that is what I've been up to. It's been a busy 2 weeks, though, so a lot of other things going on as well.
Yeah, Witcher 3 is another one, a game that's absolutely worth the price. and it's you know what? I know Dark Souls are big fans, but it's almost like Dark Souls light in a way, where if you don't prep for, you know, if you don't prepare correctly, that you can lose your battles, even relatively easy ones.
There's some
obviously it's not nowhere near as vicious as the Dark Souls series, but you know, I think that's a kind of fair comparison if you haven't played Witcher 3. But I don't know how the storyline is for the Dark Souls, but Witcher's really good. They got great characters and stuff.
It's so great. I finally got up to the part where I actually finally went to speak to the Bloody Baron and did that little Ciri part. That is really, really cool. Yeah. They made her...
Oh, you're only that far in?
Oh, yeah, dude.
With storyline? Oh,
I am so many hours into that game and only so far, man. I have my map... In Velen, looks like a mess. There are notice boards everywhere, quest markers everywhere. I am not in good shape right now. I need to get a handle of what's going on.
You know, so. I had that problem too. Is I started on the story, and then you just go everywhere.
Yep.
You know, and then I'm like, no, I've got to focus on the story. Let me get to the story. But I'm so worried that because of the type of game and the type of series Witcher might be, because this is my first Witcher game, everybody. That I'm worried that I'm going to be locked out of some places later on because Arkham City pulled that crap.
Right.
Like, once you got to a certain aspect of the game, they locked you out of finishing certain missions. And I don't know if that's kind of unfair to the player, you know?
Right.
Well, I understand it, like, from a story aspect, but from a gameplay aspect, you can't, and with an open world, you can't expect everybody to go the path you want when it's a sandbox.
My problem was I was caring too much about the story and gimped myself completely because I didn't have enough money to buy the armor. I ran around White Orchard getting enough gold to buy that Temerian armor that was that DLC stuff, that free DLC stuff. And I had plenty, and now I feel a little better prepared. I just need to find a better steel sword. So
See, that's the thing you've got. And the thing is, you got to upkeep your weaponry and stuff, too.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that initially. So I was like, why am I not doing any damage to these things?
And even worse is the freaking blacksmith is ridiculously expensive to repair that stuff. So I'm seeing the value of repair kits a little better. So
yeah.
But man, never enough meat to go around. I got lucky and there was a pack of wargs and wild dogs like chewing up some deer and rabbits. So I was just running around collecting off the bodies that they were making. So, and then I'd wipe them out. But, pro tip, drowners you can take out in one crossbow shot underwater. I did not know that. It made a lot of things a little more easy.
See, I haven't fought them underwater. I haven't fought them underwater yet.
Yeah, you just use the crossbow. You shoot them once, as long as they're close enough in level.
Yeah.
I was taking out level 10s, and I was only, like, level 5 and a half or something like that, so...
I've just been using fire on them when I meet them on the surface.
Yeah.
That takes care of them pretty quickly, too.
Great game. Can't wait to get further into it. Between that and No Man's Skies, I'll probably be busy a lot. And then a lot of Rainbow Six as well.
I got to circle back to Witcher eventually.
Yeah. Maybe you want to just save some money and get the Game of the Year edition they just announced and get it on the PC instead.
The problem with that game is... It's, like, intimidatingly big, you know? As opposed to, like, a GTA game.
So you don't want to go back and start over again.
Yeah, it's like, I don't know if I've got the strength of will to be able to do that.
Maybe,
like, and it's not, like, there's some games I've refused to finish like that.
Right.
Not because of that reason, because Witcher's probably really good to play again, especially after you got more experience in it. But, like, the Telltale games with the Walking Dead, I refuse to finish that series. Like, I cannot handle it emotionally anymore.
Oh, and the last thing I got for my personal thing is it's that time of the year. Get your marshmallow pumpkins and candy corn.
It's August.
I know.
Summer's not over yet.
I know. The school stuff hasn't even gone on sale yet. But Halloween candy's here. So, otherwise... The $70 million I told you so happened.
Oh, man.
Ghostbusters. Yeah. Ghostbusters is coming up $70 million short of budget.
Well, let's look at it this way. From the numbers that they've been softballing us, it's about $70-plus million in the hole. Technically, it's probably closer to $100-plus million. And even beyond that, it's roughly $1 billion. Because think about it. This was supposed to be their new starting off point for a film franchise.
Yep.
This was supposed to make $500 million at least.
Yeah.
Then, beyond that, it was supposed to have sequels. It was supposed to have video game tie-ins. It was supposed to have action figure tie-ins. The action figures were on clearance weeks before the game.
Yeah.
Before the movie came out.
Yeah, I saw that.
The game studio went bankrupt. It was supposed to have a new cartoon, which I guess they're still kind of trying to do.
I'm going to clear one thing up really quick. That game studio was already going bankrupt before they accepted the job. They were trying to keep themselves afloat by taking that contract. So that's not their fault, but it didn't help the buyer either.
But I'm just giving examples that
the game
obviously did not help them.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, their max players at one point were 16.
Ugh.
Out of all the people that bought it, 16 were, So they really shot themselves. You know what? And here's the thing. Everybody kept warning them, like, you know, maybe you shouldn't make fun of the fans. Maybe you shouldn't insult the fans. Fantastic Four did that exact same thing. You were insulting the fans throughout. Oh, you'll go see it anyway. No, we won't.
yeah, definitely not.
And they try to pander to a certain type of crowd. And guess what? That crowd is not the type to reward you with purchases. Like, for me, you know, there's a bunch of... Look behind me. I love Venom. So I'll buy pretty much anything that has, like, the Eddie Brock Venom in there.
Right.
You know, that statue was probably $200 or plus. You know, I'll buy all the books with Venom. I'll buy video games with Venom. So we, as consumers, we are going to reward you if we like what we see.
And we are going to punish you if we don't.
Does not do that. They think that doing it is its own reward. Is that, no, you should be doing this anyway. And being a company that's supposed to be making money, because yes, we might be emotionally invested in Ghostbusters, but every single thing was meant to make money. But at the same time, it had to make money by being good, you know?
Right.
You have to actually put out a quality product. They didn't put out a quality product. You know, even the best of reviews said it was mediocre.
Yeah, at best.
At best. And that's not how you want to start your franchise, your extended universe, which everybody needs to quit reaching for the extended universe.
Right.
You can't just make it happen. It has to build, in a way you have to make it happen, but it has to develop on its own in a way, you know? Be like, oh, we could reference this here. Not, hey, we need these references in this. Build it around this. That doesn't work like that.
All right, well, anything else?
Oh, good news this week. Otacon was this weekend. Awesome. Hey, Ronald, Mr. Sergeant Eckerd, I loved your Professor Oak cosplay. But so that happened this weekend. I didn't realize it happened this weekend. Otherwise, I would have tried to have gone. But there was a lot of announcements that happened, Funimation especially, and I picked one up because this was like last minute stuff. Funimation announced an Overlord English dub and home video release, obviously Blu-ray or DVD, whatever. Pre-orders are going to go up on August 15th, that's tomorrow, on Funimation. Oh, actually, right now. And it'll be to purchase November 8th. If you don't know about it, here's the book. It started off as a light novel series.
That doesn't look like a light novel anymore.
Huh?
That doesn't look like a light novel anymore.
Well, no, I mean, it's obviously expanded, but it started off as a novel series about a guy who was basically a basement dweller. All he did was go to work to make money and play this video game. So he was level 100 in this game.
Sounds like me. Got it.
Yeah. But the game was shutting down. The servers were shutting down. So he decided to stay on until it, you know, kicked him off the server.
Right.
And so his screen went dark. It came back up. And he found himself trapped in this new fantasy world. He doesn't know if it's like a real world or a video game. But he's there with all of his level 100 top tier stats and all of his items. His entire dungeon, he's got basically a tower filled with an army of supernatural beings almost as powerful as him. And they're trapped in this new magical fantasy world where the most powerful people in it that he's met so far are roughly around level 30 when he's level 100.
Great.
So it's basically him trying to figure out the world and curb stomping everything that comes in his path, which initially sounds boring, but the interesting thing about it is this is a character that seems like he's read the Evil Overlord list, you know, which has gone online.
Right.
About being a genre-savvy character, and he tries to work to that. He treats his dungeon, his tower, like a workforce. You know, when his employees do good, he rewards them. You know, he doesn't punish them for, you know, the minor failures or everything. We get to see how he tries to develop and stick to this persona as an evil overlord now that he's got thinking, feeling creatures underneath him that if they teamed up on him, they probably could beat him. And while he's able to think on the fly and make it look like he planned all this stuff out in advance, he has no set plan for them, you know. But when he fights, he's planned in advance, like 7 or 15 steps ahead. He's ahead of everybody when he actually gets into a fight. You can watch the subtitle version on Funimation right now, and I highly recommend it because it goes over the first 2 or 3 books, I think. I think this book the anime only covers to like episode 3 or 4 of this book.
Oh, okay.
I think the next book comes out in September.
Oh, nice.
But I highly recommend reading the book because you get a lot more details, you get more of his insight. The anime is pretty good. It's by Madhouse, who did No Game, No Life, which is almost a similar concept, and some others. Madhouse is one of the best animation studios out there.
One of my favorites is Dot Hack. Where people get stuck in the game. I mean, that's a little different, but
are you talking about the first Dot Hack Sign?
Yeah, Dot Hack Sign. The one that the video games were based on, and that original series.
Yeah, that one was weird because it was more philosophical than anything. There's hardly any action in it. I remember when that first came out on Toonami.
Well, there was some action in it.
I mean, there was some action, but it was a lot of them asking, like, it was interesting, you know?
Well,
had some other Dot Hack series since then, but no, it was a good series.
It's those questions that should be asked, though. Why and why should you do this, or even should you do this? You know, bear was supposed to be that wise older player that, you know, gave his knowledgeable voice, so.
Right, no, it was a good series, and... And there's another one, Dot Hack Twilight or whatever I think it was, which is the name of one of the games that's also on Funimation, which is pretty good. A lot different in tone than the one we're talking about.
Right,
the
right.
Sign. Highly recommend this series. Go check it out. They've announced the English cast list for the main character, Momonga, is Chris Guerrero. You know, like the wrestlers.
Right.
And Saltier Bloodfallen is Felicia Angeli. Obviously, the cast is a lot larger than that. And it would have taken us forever to read them all off.
Right.
But I just wanted to grab... They're two of the main characters, roughly.
And you said that comes out November 8th, correct?
Right. You can purchase it November 8th. The pre-orders are starting today, and I am going to grab them.
Gotcha. All right, well, let's go ahead and move into the comic news. We've got Legion set in the MCU.
Okay, this is a rumor, so rumor alarm for that.
Where's it at?
I don't know. I don't have the buttons in front of me.
Why is that so quiet? There you go. Okay, there's your rumor alarm.
Okay, so according to an article on Marvel.com, they've set Fox's upcoming Legion listed alongside Luke Cage and some others, like Jessica Jones, Defenders. But here's the thing. This is probably a nothing story, but I thought it was kind of funny to throw in. Because, again, it was written by Marvel.com, which is technically, like, official. But it was not written by or quoting someone with any actual authority to make those kind of decisions. Right. So, in other words, it could be just a typo and oversight. On the other hand, Marvel Chief Creative Officer Joe Quesada did pitch the Legion trailer as a brand new Marvel show. Scott Derrickson, the director of Doctor Strange, did also say that Doctor Strange will begin the Marvel Cinematic Multiverse, which could perhaps redefine what we think of as the MCU.
That's interesting, because I didn't really like that idea for DC, because I think it's too much. And that's the reason why I'm mad about DC movies and DC TV shows not matching up.
Well, the problem is DC's not doing it organically like we just discussed about an extended universe. Theirs feels a lot more forced, and it feels... And they started at the wrong point. They tried to start at point C when they should have started at A. And now they're trying to work back to A and then move up. And a lot of their stuff isn't making sense. Like, you know, how come Batman is killing people in Batman versus Superman, but then he's just capturing people in the other movies, you know, and arresting them? People that should die, you know? These aren't like 9-to-5 guys that were hired to defend a truck, you know? Yeah, they might be armed mercenaries or whatever, but they're basically security guards.
Right.
And he's killing them when the Joker is running around, or people like Deadshot are running around, which he's a super assassin, you know?
Right.
So why is it okay for him to kill these regular guys and not kill them? You can't. That's the problem with a character kind of like Batman, you know? And that's why the Punisher, who does kill people, has very few recurring villains, except for one who might have a healing factor of some sort, or is partially mutant, partially cyborg, or something. So it's like you can't have it both ways, DC.
Right.
Yeah, I understand. You know, now you could do it the reverse, where like people like the Joker, he does kill, but security guards, he just beats them up and maybe breaks their arms or legs.
Right.
But they don't have hundreds or thousands of deaths behind them, as opposed to somebody like the Joker, or again Deadshot, or Killer Croc, Killer Croc probably wouldn't have thousands, but he'd probably have a few dozen.
Right. Anybody who's dumb enough to go in the sewers, huh?
Yeah, you know, if he depending on the writer, you know.
All
because
right.
He's killed and eaten people before.
I didn't even bring up the pictures. There's a picture.
So I have not. I think the Legion trailer was released. I've not seen that yet.
Oh, you haven't seen it yet? Yeah, it was released at SDCC.
Okay, yeah. So I still haven't seen it. Have you seen it?
Yeah, I watched it. It was interesting. It was a lot of him being stuck in the interrogation room they had him in, talking to him.
Okay, so it was more like a little teaser or whatever.
Yeah, it was more or less a teaser. It wasn't really giving you an idea of what's really going on yet.
Mm-hmm.
But it looked interesting.
Now, we've discussed the character of Legion before. He was the son of, I believe, Mormon Taggart and Professor Xavier. He was an extremely powerful psychic mutant with multiple personalities, and each personality had its own power set. Like one would be pyrokinetic, one could time travel, all this other stuff. So I find it funny that him being locked in a interrogation room is only because either one of the personalities is extremely passive, or he wants to be there.
Right. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly the feeling you get from it, because he's not on the defensive in that room. He does not.
Okay.
He does not seem like he is.
Like kind of like the Agent 47 scene.
I'm not locked in here with you. You're locked in here with me.
Well, that's from Watchmen, but...
Well, they
yeah, he said the same thing, yeah.
He said the same thing.
But, so. So if that's true, and, you know, there's always been rumors circulating that well, Fox isn't happy with what the X-Men movies are doing. Maybe they're trying to cut a deal, especially after Fantastic Four. Although I've also heard unbiased or unconfirmed rumors that Marvel or Fox was happy with how Apocalypse did. I mean, I guess it did well.
They're just in love with Singer. That's what they are.
Pretty much. They really need to get rid of him. I think he's kind of burned out in more ways than one. Not necessarily drugs, though. Okay.
All right. Well, the next thing we've got is Ghost Rider's getting a new book. That looks... and here's the cover right here on the for those of you watching the video. It's got him standing on top of his... what is that? Is it a...
It looks to be his... Now, he can make vehicles out of his Hellfire, or he can manipulate... he can mutate other vehicles. So it just looks like it's his souped-up Hellfire car.
Right.
And this is also Robbie Reyes. It's not Johnny Blaze, which is one of the classic... Ghost Riders. So... and this is because he's going to be in the new season of Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. You've seen that, right?
Right, yeah. Yeah, I think we mentioned it offhand.
Yeah, so he's taking up the mantle of Ghost Rider once more with a new ongoing series from Marvel Comics. According to TV Guide, co-creator Felipe Smith will return to pen Robbie's new adventures with Danilo Bayruth on interior art and co-creator Trad Moore providing backup stories. Here's a quote. Prior Ghost Riders were compelled to do good, Smith explained, of the character, who is not experiencing a vengeance, but rather a young man possessed by the specter of a serial killer named Eli Morrow, whatever. Robbie makes the choice to do good things because it's the spirit who compels him to kill. So, that's... I don't really know Robbie that much, but the spirit of vengeance is like a fallen angel sometimes. It depends on the writer again. It's either a fallen angel that the devil is in control of or some kind of demon, and they only act when there's evil around them. And they attack people who deserve vengeance. Like there was one time Ghost Rider tried to fight the Hulk during World War Hulk, and when the spirit of vengeance is in full control, he is one of the most powerful beings on the Marvel planet.
Right.
Doctor Strange has even said that his powers are godlike. So technically he could have defeated the Hulk. But once he got a good look up close and understood the Hulk's justifications, he left him alone because the Hulk was completely justified in his need for vengeance.
Right.
So this is a different one. I'm wondering how he's able to... Of course, I guess with Supernatural, you really don't have to explain it, but how can he replicate feats on that kind of level when it's just a ghost, basically? A serial killer ghost.
Right.
But whatever. In his new series, Robbie will find himself teaming up with a few other Marvel comic characters, including Adamus Cho, who is the totally awesome Hulk right now, because they killed off Bruce Banner, spoiler alert, because they're just demanding that Cho be the new Hulk, as supposed to be in his more interesting persona, as one of the top 10 geniuses in the world. I thought that was a really far more unique and fun personality for him, but okay, let's just make him a Hulk ripoff. Laura Kinney's Wolverine, which, again, that's a more organic transition for her to take up the mantle.
Right.
Because Robbie is a little more serious of a character, Smith says he will find kinship with Wolverine. Having characters who are the same age but from different backgrounds is always interesting, he said. More likely than not, there's going to be friction. He hopes to bring Kamala Khan's Miss Marvel, who is the new shape-shifting Miss Marvel, into the fold sometime soon. So there you have it. I don't know which Ghost Rider they're going to use for the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I don't know how he's going to work into the show because the show's mostly being science fiction. And Ghost Rider is traditionally a type of, inspired by biblical theology, I guess would be the correct way of saying that. The classic angels and demons type of stuff.
Gotcha.
So how they're going to explain him and his abilities on again, or maybe they just are going to have to admit it. Maybe that's one of the interesting things for the show is that they're going to have to admit, okay, this is a legit supernatural force that we are dealing with. This isn't like Thor, whose technology is so advanced that it's considered magic on our level, but this is actual magic type right. stuff, which would be cool.
I gotcha.
It's always kind of neat when you have scientific minded people having to admit that type of shit. Oh, right. Excuse me.
You're fine. All right. Well, and you want to round out the comics then?
Yeah, I'll finish this off. So this absolutely surprised nobody.
Yeah, I called it.
Really? Yeah.
I told you.
Powers has been canceled after the second season, according to a tweet from Brian Michael Bendis, the creator of the comic, and part of, I think, executive producer, writer on the show.
This happens when you are not Netflix, Hulu, or Amazon, by the way. Not that I've really watched any Hulu original movies or shows, but exactly what you have here, limited exposure. People are going to go buy Netflix for other things. The average person can do Netflix easier than they're going to want to go out and buy a game console to watch your show.
Yeah, you know, you're already talking about a $400-plus game console. Then you got to sign up for PSN, and then you've got to pay. I think you know PSN. You don't have to pay a monthly subscription, do you?
I think you do now.
Oh, do you now?
I think they changed it.
Well, and so then you've got them paying for that. So there, you're looking at, you know, $400-plus right there just to watch your show. Not your average person isn't going to do that. And you had your pilot on YouTube. They got pretty good exposure. I even said, you know, if this was on Netflix or whatever, I would watch this, but I'm not going to go out of my way to watch this on, you know, another system.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, and here's the thing. You can get Netflix on your mobile. You can get your Netflix on cell phone. You can get it on your laptop. You can get it on your main PC. You can get it on your Xbox. You can get it on your Wii. You can get it on your PlayStation.
I can get it on my TV.
You can get it straight into your TV. You could probably get it on your refrigerator, depending on what type of refrigerator you have. It's on absolutely everything. And Hulu is on everything. YouTube is on everything.
Amazon Prime on everything.
Amazon Prime is on everything. You know, that's why these shows do so well.
HBO. HBO Now just came to the Samsung TVs within the last few months. We've been short of it, and we've just had to use the Chromecast instead. But now it's right on our Samsung Smart TV. I don't have to plug in that damn Chromecast anymore. I can keep it in the room that I have it in. So they are making smart moves to get themselves in positions to be able to show to the general public where they're not going to mind paying that money because they're not just doing it for your Powers show. I don't think Sony's original lineup is really that great either anyways, so.
Now, you know, this probably could have been like a
joint venture. They could have done a joint venture with HBO or Amazon Prime or with Amazon or whatever. And even not even had to pay for the whole bill if they knew that it was going to be something that people wanted to see. That's all those companies care about. They want to bring more viewers to their hold.
Exactly, you know. And so I don't doing something like this doesn't make sense. I don't know. I don't even know what else the PSN shows.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I know it doesn't show this anymore.
Yeah. Well, after the second season, yeah. I don't even know if the second season's over. I haven't seen anybody post on Facebook, "Oh, have you seen the episode 15 of Powers, man? It was so great." Nobody was watching it because nobody has access to it.
Well, to be fair, everybody was talking about it at first, but it was all the hype.
What? Because it was on YouTube.
Yeah, they got to see
you
that one.
You go on YouTube right now and go look at that pilot episode.
Yeah. That's
so,
what I'm saying.
Yes, everybody was talking about it. But after that, I did not see one message say, "Oh, well, I got to buy a PlayStation 4 for this." So really, I kind of feel bad for everybody involved because it looked like they're putting together a good show, or at least a decent show.
Right.
You know, maybe Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. level. We're not talking about top of the line like Stranger Things or Daredevil
right.
or anything.
Right.
But it was probably a pretty decent show. The comic has a decent kind of like superpowered mystery type of thing. So whatever. Sad to see it go, but I really don't care.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know what to say.
Yeah, there's nothing else to say. Other than we can go right into the next thing, which is the movies and TV shows.
The movies and TV shows.
That'll kill everybody's ears. I realized I had that up too loud, and I need to keep that down for the next one. All right, next thing up, movies and TVs. Go ahead and take this one, because this is all you. Even though
Yeah, cool so picture. Who loves Godzilla? I do. Who loves anime? I do again. So following the release of Godzilla Resurgence, which just came out, and it's supposed to be coming over to America. I don't know if it has already or not, because I haven't been keeping up with things. It looks like Toho is developing a Godzilla anime project. Anime News Network has reported that Toho has registered the domain Godzilla-anime.com, which currently only lists three domains related to the site, which is Godzilla-anime, www.godzilla-anime, and www.godzilla-anime.com. All those are .coms if I didn't say it. No further news or confirmation in regards to a Godzilla anime project has come from Toho as of yet. I don't know if anything was announced recently. I haven't seen. I think that would be a pretty big deal because we really haven't ever had a Godzilla anime.
Right.
We've had a couple of U.S. versions. you know, the Godzilla Power Hour thing, whatever.
Right, and, right.
Then we had the one that was based off the 98 Godzilla movie. And that one was actually a pretty okay show. You know, it looked like it was by the same animators as the Men in Black and a couple of other shows. And maybe Rusty, Big Guy and Rusty the Boy Robot. So I had those kinds of things. But hey, Godzilla did recently appear in anime form last month in a crossover with Crayon Shin-Chan. And there have been a couple of, I'll just say that, and there's been a couple of different American cartoons. If you haven't watched Crayon Shin-Chan, I don't know where you can get it. There's probably some sites you can watch a subtitled version of the Japanese side, but Funimation did a gag dub of it, which churned a lot of the humor, which it's about Simpsons level humor right now with just the Japanese version, but it churned it to basically almost like South Park type of humor. Especially that last third season. I really wish Shin-Chan would get more seasons right. Dubbed in that format because it was hilarious. More people should have watched it. Regarding the recent live-action Godzilla Resurgence Japanese movie, Funimation recently announced they will be releasing it in the U.S. later this year. So it hasn't come out here yet. But that's one I want to go see.
Gotcha. Yeah, can't say I can't be excited about that. I mean, animes are always done so caringly, and in the hands of Japanese animators, they do a great job. So, I think they can do a really good job with Godzilla making a big comeback. You know what I mean?
Yeah, fortunately, I think Godzilla. As for a comeback, yeah, film-wise, he needs a good solid film because the last ones were pretty goofy.
And they could have been better.
They could have been better. Especially this one. The first trailer looked really good. And I don't know. The last American movie was not that great because they have a bad habit of focusing on characters that you just don't care about.
Right.
The human element. We don't always need a human element. We've discussed this time and again.
They had the human element with Bryan Cranston, and they killed him off.
Spoilers. Yeah, the one interesting, really interesting character you had. And yeah. That was it. But,
What's even crappier about that is they basically put him in the position to where it was like he was paying for what happened to his wife. It wasn't he was killed and he could have been the hope. It was, no, they created this character, killed off his wife in a situation where he was in control. So they put him in a position where he was in control and died because of his decision. It wasn't even for anything. He died for nothing.
Yeah, a senseless sacrifice in a way.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, they could have had a complete character arc where his obsession, you know, took it over, and then he realized that, you know, I don't know, some things are beyond him. As opposed, we have this bomb squad guy who doesn't even want to be there, and
he's like,
doesn't do anything really, and he has like, no real arc aside from him and his wife are like distant or whatever. Or I don't even remember. It was so boring.
It's like Dante at the quick stop. I'm not even supposed to be here today.
Yeah.
All right. Go ahead.
No,
I thought you had something else.
So that's pretty much it for that. I just hope that it's good.
Awesome. You know what I should have done was got a good laugh for this, because this is, that laugh kills me anyways. But hey, look, Suicide Squad. Reviews were in. I heard mixed reviews from everybody. Anything from, wow, the big bad guy was terrible, to, hey, was Batman making out with Harley Quinn instead of giving her CPR?
Yeah, this has been another one of those where the reviews are all over the place. A lot of them are citing things like extremely poor editing, weak dialogue, cliche dialogue.
Oh, wait, let's talk about the only two stars of the movie that they focused on the whole time. Do you know who they were? Give you two guesses.
Deadshot and Harley Quinn.
Holy crap! Yep. Get this man a prize. Apparently, they shared most of the screen time. The worst part of the movie that I was sure that it was going to be the worst part. He was only in like I think 18 minutes of it total. The Joker.
Yeah, they cut a lot of his stuff out and they re-edited it again poorly to make him look more heroic. Which that's not what you do for the Joker. The Joker is not heroic at all. It's like they didn't understand their own characters that they owned. Supposedly, there's rumors out there that everybody had more dialogue, more personality in the original cut of it, but they cut all that. So you got all these weird lines that come out of nowhere. That, you know, they have scenes that look, they're completely out of place. Like it transitions from day to night suddenly and back again. You don't know where the characters are in reference to everything. That the tone itself is inconsistent. That the soundtrack is, you know, although they use good songs, they put them in the wrong places, and it goes over, you know, they put it in the wrong scenes, they have it running for too long or whatever.
Great.
It's like they didn't know what they wanted to do with this film. We all knew that they had a lot of reshoots with it, so,
well,
that's one thing.
So, I mean, they were verbal about the reshoots, but we talked about that with Rogue One. It had reshoots, and reshoots are actually a normal part of it, but I don't know how much more extensive those reshoots were, so I'll give them the benefit of the doubt on that, unless you have
better. Well, my thing was that, you know, it seems like they...
Though they did say they had to go back and reshoot a bunch of stuff to add in more comedy.
Yeah, see, that's where my worry comes in, is that they said stuff like that because they saw how poorly Batman vs. Superman is, because there's this thing called darkness-induced apathy, where when everybody is doom and gloom all the time, all the characters, there's nobody for you to get emotionally invested in, or right, to even care somewhat whether they die. You know, it happens a lot in very badly done horror movies where the characters are all idiots, they're right, all cliches, and nobody cares.
Right.
But, you know, so you actually root for the villain. And usually the villain has no personality, like Jason Voorhees or Michael Myers.
Right.
But they're just these unstoppable killing machines, as opposed to like a good horror movie like The First Nightmare on Elm Street, where you did have likable characters, you had an interesting villain, or Jaws, where, yes, the villain was an animal, so you didn't really understand its thought process, it's more in the book, but you had likable heroes, you had Quint, you had Brody, you had the science guy, I can't remember his name off the top of my head.
Bill Nye. No, I'm just kidding.
not Bill Nye. He had a glorious beard. You know, even the side characters, like his wife, Brody's wife, was interesting. The mayor was a jerk, but, you know, he had, like, charisma and stuff. You could see why he became the mayor.
Right, right.
So there's things like that. So, okay, the movie's doing very well, and I've heard, you know, some things. People are very diverse on Leto's Joker. Some people are saying it's the worst Joker ever. Some people are saying, no, he did okay. Some people are just like, oh, he was the best part of the movie. course, if all this other stuff is terrible, then I could see why that he might be considered the best part of the movie. But, you know, everything I've seen him in, it's just weak. It's weak and forced, and yeah, he's everything a method actor should not be.
So what I am looking at is $465 million worldwide, which I said that it would be a box office success, but I said it would not be a critical success or a critic success, which they needed, they desperately needed and wanted.
Yeah. Yeah, they really need both. They need a critical and box office success. Obviously, if they had to choose one, they would want the money. But, you know, it's like every one of their movies has been poorly reviewed. And people are saying, well, that's because it's not more like Marvel movies, because Marvel movies are so cliched and stuff. No, Marvel movies are cliched in a way, because they're comic book movies, and all comic books are really cliched. But they hit the right notes with a general audience, people that don't know the characters. They hit the right notes, as in, yes, it has a well-defined beginning, it has a well-defined middle, and it has a well-defined end, and we see how the characters progress there. Sure, are there some like weird leaps in logic? Like Civil War had some weird leaps in logic, especially with its main villain.
Right.
That could have been easily fixed with just a few extra lines of dialogue. You know, this one, it's just everywhere with it. It's got weird flashbacks again. They're played by flashbacks. You know, and they don't adhere to the own rules in the story. And I'm not going to spoil anything, but I still love the idea that the government wanted to put together a task force to be able to take down Superman level threats.
Right.
And so what do they get? They get a psycho with a bat. They get two guys that can shoot really good. They got a guy that throws boomerangs, and they got a guy that can climb really good.
Right.
His power is climbing good. He uses grappling hook, so it's not even climbing good. It's he can hold on to the gun while it drags him up. It does most of the work. And they got a crocodile man who, even on his best days, can't tangle with Bane, much less Superman.
Right, right.
So, but here's where the real controversy comes from. DC fans overreact because that's what fans do, and demanded Rotten Tomatoes, a site that just gathers reviews. It's like the Google search of reviews, basically. It pulls them all together.
What's that word? There's a word for that.
Aggregate.
Aggregate, there you go.
It's an aggregate site. And Warner Brothers owns like 30% of it. Yeah. Like 10 to 30% of the website. And they wanted to take it down. They had this They had this massive protest on it.
Warner Brothers didn't want it taken down.
Warner Brothers didn't want to take it down. The fans wanted to take it down. Warner Brothers makes money off the site.
Nobody's saying DC doesn't have rabid fans. We're just saying they're not the smartest people.
Well, by definition, fanboys are not the smartest of people. Oh, okay. And that goes for me included. When I get emotional about something, very stupid things.
Look at that shipwreck that was Warcraft. I mean, I think it's perfect, but everybody else thought it was garbage.
But yeah. You know, and that's the tricky thing is when you know all the lore like we do for, you got to realize when you go into a film, it's got to be designed in a way so the general audience can understand it. They're not going to understand what happened in Amazing Spider-Man issue 129 or, you know, obviously volume 1, the first one.
Is Enchantress even a big deal? I mean, I heard she did some weird wavy arm crap and wasn't impressive at all.
I don't know if she's quite on that level that they put her in the movie. They were really inconsistent with the movie.
I feel like they just put the Suicide Squad up against a normal bad guy, and she was just smarter than they were.
In the film, her power. So obviously, at this point, we have to say the comic book version versus the film version. The film version, she's a massive threat, and she was the powerhouse of the team. She would have been the one to take on a Superman-like threat while the other one stood around and did quips.
Right.
So I'm not too sure, really.
No, yeah. I mean, considering we haven't seen it either, so.
Yeah, well, of course, if you've watched any of the comic book sites, leading up to this film for the last year, Like every 5 minutes, it's been, you won't believe what Leedu's done on site on the to the cast this time. He's so crazy. He's an absolute madman. I can't tell if he's Leedu or the Joker anymore.
He's so edgy.
He's so edgy. Mom's going to freak when she sees this. Will Smith asked for sugar and I gave him salt. Oh my goodness. How Will Smith didn't take one of those prop guns and beat him to death.
Right.
They must have paid him good. Oh my God, if I had been on that, I could imagine having to be on set with this guy all the time and him doing his method acting, which a lot of veteran actors will say method acting is the weakest form of acting. They say just act.
Right.
You know, of course, there's been really good method actors out there, but Leto is not one of them. That's not how you do it.
Right.
You know, who's the chick from The Devil Wears Prada? Meryl Streep? Was she in that?
Yes.
Yes. Now, she's a good method actor. Because, like, I heard when she went and saw...
The difference is that the people that pick her for films have written the role specifically for her.
Yeah.
Because they know they can get that effect out of her.
That, and plus, it's Meryl Streep. You know, she's one of the greatest actors of all time. You know, Leto, yes, he's won an Oscar, but he was just Jared Leto in the role. It was just a good film. You know, so it was like one of those films that they throw out there and it wins every award. I don't know how many awards it won that time, but, you know, I don't know. I got into a massive argument online about this because, you know, winning arguments is the most important thing ever. But, right. Whatever. So there it is.
All right.
You know, it really ruined me wanting to see it, though. Because there's basics to storytelling that you, especially for like a superhero film, that you've got to hit. It's not an artsy house. It's not an art house film where you could really play with the medium, you know?
It's also been 2 weeks since I said I'd watch Superman or Batman versus Superman, and I still haven't done that. So I'm close, though. I think we might watch it in the next couple of days, so.
It just feels like a chore at this point, doesn't it?
Yeah,
you're like,
yeah, it does.
I guess I need to watch it.
It does. It does, for sure.
That's not good for a film.
For anyways. Sure. All right. Well, let's get into the video games, our last section here, as always. All right. Next picture and big screen. There we go. Hey, rumors are out there about StarCraft getting an HD remake. Where's that thing at? Yeah, there it is. Yeah.
Rumor.
Huge rumor, but a important one nonetheless if it actually gets done. StarCraft is still a huge esport over in, I want to say South Korea. Mostly,
yeah, I think it's Korea. But I think it's Korea and like Vietnam.
Still wider in the esports realm. People still play regular StarCraft because it's not because of the graphics. It's not because of the you know, the overall appeal for StarCraft. I mean, people that like StarCraft moved on to StarCraft 2. This is for the people that play it are probably the ones that play it for the mechanics, anyways. But for it to get an HD remake, I mean, it's becoming a standard. They've already done this with Age of Empires, which was a good old PC game. That got an HD remake. Stuff like that. Same type of game, but, you know, it's just to breathe more life into it. And it's a good thing because, I mean, it's, you know, it's being played still. It's not going to be hard to sell it to these people that want it. Or
well,
even
here's the
big fans.
Yeah, StarCraft's a good game, and that's the reason it's still played. It's not, like you said, it's not the graphics, it's not the story, which is, it's got a good story. It's because they pretty much nailed the mechanics and the balance the first time around.
Right.
You know?
Well, I mean, it's probably on the list of things that still gets updated, too, like Diablo and Diablo 2 as well. I mean,
I don't know. How old is this game? It's almost, it's pushing 20 years now, isn't it?
90s? It should be. Why you ask questions I'm not ready for?
Keep you on your toes.
I'm looking. Keep talking.
Well, yeah, like we said, it's a execution wise, mechanic wise, it's pretty perfect. There is no single aspect of the game that is really off balance that can't be countered by somebody else. There's dozens of strategies out there that you can utilize. I love the game. I'm not a big RTS fan, and I love the game, even though, yes, when I was younger, I used the cheats nonstop because I was into the story. I wasn't playing competitively.
98.
So in 2 years, right?
Yep.
Oh, my goodness, we're old.
Yeah, and in that span of 98, they released two expansions for it, too. And, those were relatively easier to make back then, so.
That's true. It was the Brood Wars, right? Brood Wars or something.
Insurrection and Brood Wars, yeah.
Okay. All right, I bought it as like that, the Battle Chest or whatever they have for them at the time. So, and it, but yeah, you know, I would totally be on board for an HD remake of the game because some of the character models are not quite there.
Yeah.
If you compare StarCraft 1 to StarCraft 2, it's like, wow, I did not expect you to look like that.
But that's what I'm saying. I mean, yeah. You know, it wasn't about the graphics. It was about the system. I mean, back then it was about the graphics, but now it's not about the graphics. It's about the system, which goes to show you that people will play games even if they don't have the best of graphics as long as the engine and the systems are there to support it. I mean, I'll go back and play... I want to go back and play the HD remakes of like Baldur's Gate and stuff like that because
here's the thing. With a game, at the very end of it, it boils down to, is this a fun game to play?
Yeah.
And I can't tell you how many times I went back and played Super Mario Brothers, the first one.
Right.
Well, technically, you know, the first Super Mario Brothers. There was a game called Mario Brothers before that, which was an arcade game. But
I also owned Super Mario Brothers.
So go ahead. What were you saying? You also what?
I also own that on the NES, the original Mario Brothers game.
Oh yeah, I have it on like the NES. I think I have it on the Super NES. I have it on, I have it on the Wii. I think I have it on the Wii U. I have it on my 3DS.
Hey, it was a good solid arcade game. I mean, you can't go wrong with it. So, all right. Anything else on StarCraft? I think
I mean, that's pretty much it. Hopefully, it's a rumor, real thing because StarCraft, compared to Warcraft, doesn't get that much attention.
Right, right.
And I think that's unfortunate. I've been begging. Like, I don't know. Like, when Warcraft initially released, or World of Warcraft, I should say, because I never played the original Warcraft, I was always hoping that they had some kind of reference to StarCraft in World of Warcraft, and I never saw one.
Well, supposedly they all exist in the same universe.
The same universe, right. But, yeah.
You know.
Which I was always hoping that you'd see, like, a down Protoss ship or some kind or whatever.
Yeah. Or a Leviathan just crash somewhere.
Yeah, or you know, it would have been really cool.
Right.
But you know, I don't know. That's just I'd love more attention to be made to the StarCraft franchise. I think they've said that it's pretty much done with after the last StarCraft 2 expansion.
The team's getting realigned, whether that means behind a new project or people have been kicking around the possibility that Diablo 4 might actually be in development already. And that might be one of their big announcements because they do not have anything huge to announce at BlizzCon this year. Legion's coming out at the end of August. StarCraft's done. Diablo doesn't really have an expansion on the lineup, but it could do with a whole new game. One that's more well thought out than 3 was, even though 3, I still love it, but it got repetitive after a while. If they had a longer campaign or other stuff that would improve it. Overwatch just came out. Heroes of the Storm is still going strong. Hearthstone just got an expansion today, I think it released.
Was it that night at whatever?
The night in Karazhan. Awesome idea.
Here's the weird thing. I saw a commercial for that on Hulu. And I was looking at it. Because I didn't see where it said Hearthstone on there initially, and I was half asleep when I saw it, and I was like, did somebody really just take the models? Because I thought it was one of those, like, the...
one of those knockoff games or something.
Yeah. I was like, somebody just stole Warcraft designs and made this game out.
So
Blizzard is going to sue their asses off.
So the design philosophy for that Hearthstone team is that because Hearthstone bears the title of Heroes of Warcraft, or the subtitle of Heroes of Warcraft, that this is the card game that people in the World of Warcraft would play.
Yeah.
So they do a take on things that are in World of Warcraft and make them this to-do event. Like, one of the earliest raids, which is the same thing as this Karazhan, was Naxxramas, which is the hangout for the Lich King, kinda. Or, well, kinda. I mean, you know, his minions and stuff operated out of one of those big floating pyramids. But it had a wing treatment, and it wasn't to the scale of what was actually in Warcraft. So this is a turn on the events, and, you know, you imagine people talking about what happened at Karazhan, and it kind of also ties into what the movie was about and all that good stuff. So there's all this stuff that's going on. But it's meant to be that kind of fun release for that type of thing. So it's
yeah.
Neat.
Well, that's what I took it as, was like, you know, after I paid more attention to the commercial, I was like, is this kind of like their equivalent to them being in Vegas?
I guess. Or
I mean,
I guess,
it's just the way the trailer came off.
Or a Studio 54 thing.
Or that, yeah.
Yeah.
So I guess we'll talk about that later. Are you going to try it out?
Yeah, actually, Hearthstone's free for everyone, but those expansions like that are, they're changing up how the seasonal stuff works and all that, and the cards from that you get as rewards only last for so long, but, there's a prologue to the events, to where you actually play as, I think you play against or as Medivh or whatever, playing the hand out, but everybody can play that for free. It's kind of like a teaser for the adventure, is what they call them.
Okay.
So, you can go try that. Totally didn't think about bringing that up, but that's fine. Kind of talked about it earlier. No Man's Sky came out on Tuesday for the PlayStation players, and then Friday for me and all the other PC players. I spent hours watching people play it on the PS4 when I couldn't. And finally, when I got to, I was pretty impressed. And it's an interesting title. I mean, I don't know that I'd be that streamer that paid $1,300 for an advanced copy, if that, you know, if that's even what he did. But it is a combination of Minecraft and, say, like one of those. Trader games. Do you remember back when Palm Pilots were a thing, and there was the games like Drug Wars and Space Wars, where you would fly or drive to different hoods and sell drugs and buy drugs, and then go to another hood and then sell them again?
Or here's one, which Pro Jared reviewed this game, High Seas Trader.
Yeah, anything that involves trading, that's a huge part of it. But it plays really well, and I may be on the lucky side because I have a higher end computer that I just built in November, so I might be better off than most. But there was a lot of complaints that there were issues with graphics hitching and textures and all that. I think it's fine for what it is. Was it worth $60? I don't know. For me, I guess so. It has, you know, the exploration thing that, you know, scratches my itch. Starbound was, you know, a clone of Terraria, but had space travel. This is that game minus the base building right now, until they add that in the first patch, which they've said they're going to, which should be interesting as well.
Now, they've said it's pseudo-multiplayer.
Yeah, you experience the world together with other people, but in your own instance of the world. You can play offline and then get online and upload all the data that you've uncovered, naming planets, naming new species, stuff like that. Regions within the planet and all that, too, that you can do. But you don't actually get to see anybody, and I don't know if that's something that just never got finished, or it's intended for later, or what, because Sean Murray was all over every interview, and I'm sure you've seen that crap where he says, yeah, you're totally going to be able to see other people. Totally going to be able to run into people. And
well, because I thought I remember them initially saying that, no, you weren't going to be able to see other people.
Nope.
I thought I could have sworn that I heard them say that initially, but maybe I'm mistaken. So, yeah, they were saying, and, you know, it would have been nice if they had come out and said, yeah, we didn't get to finish it. We're going to put that in later.
Yeah,
because it would have been really cool to see how, basically, you give a bunch of multiplayer, you know, thousands of people access to this thing, and say, okay, guys, you figure out what you want to do and see what kind of, like, ecosystem develops with, because, you know, like, Minecraft can't handle that many people. What, 16 at the most, I guess? Yeah. But this, if this can really hold hundreds of thousands of players and they, you know, and the basis is there for them to set up trade routes, form armadas, take over areas, it would have been really cool to see what kind of dynamic would have come up.
Yeah,
come
it could
up,
have totally
you know?
Been different, and it's, I don't know. I wish it would have been more. I wish I could have flown around with my buddies, because, I mean, you see formations of ships flying around planets and stuff. Just civilian ships, nobodies. They land at stations, and you can trade with them, and that's it. So,
and, well, hopefully this is just like the ground floor, the cornerstone, and they're going to develop all this stuff, because this has the potential to be something major, you know?
So after
reading Ready Player One and then hearing this coming out, I'm like, this is exactly what that game was, or that book was talking about. And obviously, like, stuff like Overlord and stuff had that same kind of aspect where it's like, you know, these are the rules of the game, but as for story-wise and, you know, what you could do, you can pretty much do whatever. You're just limited to what we could physically put in there.
Well, and that's what sucks. And I mean, I think I want to blame Sony. This is their fault. And I think Hello Games should blame them as well. Because I wonder how much of their backing of this game has affected the word of mouth. Because this game was super overhyped. It literally was. It really was. That's why I was going to avoid it. But it has the potential to be better. The problem is that Sony got a hold of it, said, hey, look at this great new game. This is going to be great. 18 quintillion planets. Look at what these guys are doing over here. These 14 developers. There are only 14 people working on this game. And they said recently with the release and all the money that they've gotten for pre-orders, they've hired another QA team because apparently Sony's QA team sucks.
You know, if you've read The Trenches from the guys at Penny Arcade and whoever, the Control Alt Delete guy, I think it is, Scott whatever, they have stories based off of QA personnel in games. So it seems like just being a QA person sucks in general.
Well, that's fine. No, totally.
But what I was going to build off of that is that they could be just so jaded. You know, if Sony sent it over a team that they had, they could have been so jaded on developers not listening to them that when you have this team of eager young developers saying, guys, tell us what's wrong, tell us what we need to fix, what we should add, and they send back nothing. You know, I wonder what, again, and that circles back around to saying that it's Sony's fault. And I don't think Hello Games, they're going to be big enough right now to be able to throw them under the bus like that, because they still need that Sony money and that Sony push, you know, to maintain themselves right now. Because this is their first release, and this is a big release. Who knows how much, you know, if, you know, the cost of servers and everything for them to keep this thing online for everybody is going to be.
Right. I'm trying to see if there was any patches or anything recently.
Yeah.
But I don't think so. Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to just say, you know, maybe in 2 or 3 years, if they throw out a couple of other games, if this game really explodes, you know, if they're able to put in actual physical multiplayer, you know, where you can see other characters and interact with them.
Right.
And they could start standing on their own two legs. They could say, yeah, our initial release was rocky because Sony really limited us. You know, and be a little more aggressive, because Sony right now, yes, it's two very different parts of the same company, but they're under the Sony brand.
Right.
Sony is not looking good at anything right now. Look at the pictures that they're releasing, the films.
Right.
You know, it's basically the end of the year. They've really gotten Sausage Party to fall back on to make them some money, because.
Yeah.
Their Ghostbusters thing didn't work. Even their Amazing Spider-Man, I don't know when that released, earlier this year or what. No, it released a couple of years ago. But none of their movies really soared.
Right.
They've only had a couple of really good or decent releases, and they've been hampered too much, so I don't know.
Right.
What I was saying is that people would totally believe that Hello Games got screwed by the Sony.
Well, and that's
this,
and that's
if they
Well, that's the problem, though, is that people are just out going out and blaming Hello Games right away, and it's like, well, I don't know what the money brought, you know what I mean? What the problems that Sony brought were, so... And they're going to wrongly point at Hello Games.
Because remember, that check, that whatever, you know, EA, Sony, whoever gives you, it comes with a very big asterisk at the end of all those zeros that they give you.
We're going to say, hey... Yeah, we're going to give you this QA team, and you need to go out there and tell them how great this game's going to be, even if you have to lie about it to get sales.
Yep, non-disclosure agreements. Again, go check out Midnight's Edge, not really a review, but they discussed the Ghostbusters incident where they, during the Sony email leak and hack, where Sony was talking about internally going legally after Bill Murray and Ernie Hudson and everybody, if they did not appear in the new Ghostbusters film, and if they didn't go out there and speak positively about it.
Yeah.
Seriously,
yeah.
I mean, I'm, have you seen them videos?
Yeah, no, I heard about it, and it was always the question I had with, what's-his-face, Dan Aykroyd, so.
Dan Aykroyd just wants Ghostbusters to be a thing, so, you know,
He wants to stay relevant.
But, yeah, you know, I don't remember the last time he's made a actual film, so... And it's sad because he was one of my favorite actors in the, you know, 80s and 90s.
Well, I mean, even within the last few years, he's still been doing great things. I mean,
what's he been in? Like,
I don't know. The last thing that I can remember that was one of the later things was Revolution, which I think was early 2000s or mid 2000s, something like that.
I never watched that. The last thing so I remember seeing him in and going, "Hey, that's Dan Aykroyd," is the movie Evolution.
Evolution, yeah, that one. That was the one I meant. Yeah. Not Revolution. Revolution was the damn TV show. Evolution, yeah. That one was a good one.
Where he played the mayor or governor or whatever.
Yeah, the governor of Arizona or whatever.
That was very early 2000s.
Was it?
Because they had the cartoon that came out later, and it was awful because it was, like, so cliche. They put the black guy as, like, the athlete in it. In the movie, he was a scientist or he was a teacher.
He was he was a teacher, but he was a class A coach or whatever.
He's like a volleyball.
That was the joke. That was the joke when they were gonna amputate his leg or whatever to get that bug out of him. He says, "You can't do that." He thinks he's an athlete. That was the joke.
But they turned him into like a legit athlete in the
2001. 2001. That movie holds up completely. That's a good movie.
Why didn't it get bigger than it was?
Alienators, Evolution Continues. I never heard about this.
You that never saw
great.
It?
Great.
Oh yeah, so it was dumb. Like it was like the Ghostbusters without the interesting aspects to it.
26 episodes, and the final episode was called Endgame. So, oh wait, or was it? Yeah, no. Yeah, original air date. So, all right. Well, that's enough about that. No Man's Sky. Love it or hate it. See if you can find somebody that has a copy so you can try it before you buy it.
Now, you're streaming it some, right?
And I am streaming it on my channel. There are already three parts to my 8-hour journey. So
okay, I'll probably check out. I don't see. I'm conflicted on that. Like, if it's a game I'm interested in, I don't want to watch people play it. Like, I don't really care. I know it's a good game, but I really don't care about Rainbow Six, so I don't mind watching people stream it. You know?
Yeah, but
if it's a game that I feel like I'm going to be interested in, I don't want to see anything about it. But I'm going to check out at least the first video you got.
Well, how far into Witcher are you?
I'm farther than you.
Yeah, okay.
So I can go back and watch your stuff. Now, if it's a game I've already beaten, you know, then I'll go and watch other people play it. So
I got you.
That's different. You know?
I got you.
If it's a game
you can watch me struggle.
Huh?
Yeah, so you can watch me struggle.
Yeah, I can be like, well, at least I wasn't that bad, which I was really bad. I'm so glad I didn't stream mine.
Well, that's what I was worried about, and, you know, people have helped me out, so whatever.
Let me put it this way. I didn't realize that I had to dodge in the game. I'm used to just playing characters that can tank the hits, you know?
Yeah, not Geralt or Geralt.
No, it's such a well-built game. He's compared to humans, he's powerful, even though you can get killed by him, but...
I'm learning. I'm very, very quickly trying to find that spot where you can do the parry.
Uh-huh.
I'm getting better against the humans, but it's really hard against the monsters. So
let me go ahead and tell you, if you haven't figured this out already, if you're fighting anybody on horseback, here's the best thing to do: shoot fire, make the horse buck,
and they'll
knock them off, and then run around there and just insta-kill them.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I actually knocked over something yesterday and got one of the instant kill prompts that I didn't know would happen. So,
yeah, I got jumped by a gang. Half of them were on horses, half of them weren't one time. And once I realized I could do that, I wiped them out in a heartbeat.
I also got something the Griffin's Head.
Yes.
The Griffin's Head, 10% chance to dismember. I love seeing guys get dismembered. Holy crap. This is like the first time I actually saw somebody get dismembered was last night. And I'm 6 parts into that stream. So it was pretty amazing. But all right, last thing so we can get out of here so I can go play some games, which I desperately want to do. All right, Rainbow Six Siege. Band waves have been hitting it by storm since, I think, Thursday? I want to say it was either Wednesday or Thursday, maybe even Tuesday. And I just didn't notice because I didn't play. Well, I think I played Tuesday. I don't remember. Anyways. People have been seeing bans come across the screen, which kind of were happening before, but not really well. Ubisoft this week activated completely their BattleEye software. And to give you a little background on it, I don't know if you remember, a couple of weeks ago, there was a free weekend on Steam for Rainbow Six Siege.
Mm-hmm.
During that weekend, they turned on BattleEye services partially. BattleEye collected all kinds of data on things that people were using to cheat in the game. Okay, so aimbots, stuff like that. Things that gave players an unfair advantage by using another piece of software to do something for them that they probably could do but just didn't want to do it. I don't know. I can't figure out why people cheat anyways. But anyways, they've had it on for the past 2 weeks collecting data. And when they turned it on Tuesday, everything went crazy. Somebody said within 4 games they saw 100 bans go out. Basically what it did, it's taking down information of other programs that are being used that have been put on a blacklist, basically, and saying, okay, if we see this process running while they're playing this, which, I mean, at a certain point, yeah, you don't want that kind of thing because they're looking at your processes, and it has actually given some false positives, but those have been straightened out. It's taking a look at what people are using, what cheat devices or what cheat softwares, and then banning them. Not a short ban either. I think they're all permanent bans. So what happened was, back in the day, which was a couple of months ago, Overwatch launched, and then a week later, Blizzard said, we are permanently banning you if you cheat. Well, that gave Ubisoft some ideas and some stones, and they went out and figured out how to do this. So I can't tell you how much of a nice time I had Friday night and then last night playing Rainbow Six without having to deal with cheaters. It was great.
Now last night you were discussing that somebody was able to shoot you through the stairs or the wall.
Some of the walls can be shot through. Oh.
Okay.
Oh, that. Oh, yeah. Somebody that was shooting me before. That was right before they had launched. That was last.
Okay.
That was last Monday. The patch went out Tuesday. Yeah, somebody had turned the corner and just shot me through a wall. He was looking diagonally at a door that he was about to go into, looking away from where I was because I was around the corner. He just turned and shot, and I died instantly. So I know that guy was cheating. I haven't seen that guy on they've been compiling an unofficial ban list on Reddit, so it's been pretty funny to watch the names added, but I haven't seen that guy's name yet.
So, you said that some false positives have gone out. Do you know how to dispute? Is there a way to dispute this where they say, okay, yeah, the BattleEye screwed up, we'll rectify it and we apologize?
I do not know the full format. I'm hoping to never have to deal with that. And I've, played the past couple of days, so I know I'm not going to have to deal with it. But I'll have to look in to see how you dispute that. But there should be stuff on their website.
Okay, but at least they have the option. You know, there was always the worry. Some places weren't giving people an option to try to contest it.
Yeah.
And I think that's unfair because none of these systems are flawless, and there's always a chance that they can misread your information.
And Ubisoft has to understand that, especially for the fact that when this game first came out, it was $60. And some people got in on the $17 starter pack or $15, whatever it was.
Mm-hmm.
But people have spent real money on this, so they're not going to just... They're not just going to close the book on it. If you can dispute it, you can through customer service, and they'll do it case by case. I've seen reports that they have, you know, people have disputed it and have gotten it fixed. And I guess they are trying to fine-tune BattleEye to make sure that that doesn't happen anymore. So
right. Well, that's the only real concern whenever I see stuff like this come up. Well, it's good, you know, and this stuff needs to happen because when you're playing a solo game, who cares if you cheat, you know? But yeah. If you're playing a game, a competitive game where you're playing against people, it's, come on, man, that's not fun for anybody.
How does
just
it
get well, better?
That's what I'm saying. How does that fun for the person who's actually doing the cheating? Because it's doing it for them. They don't have to do anything but click the mouse button. It's like, well, go play Cookie Clicker on the internet if you want to just click your mouse. If you don't know what that is, go look at it. My son's played it a couple of times, and I yell at him because he's ruining mice. This launch came just on the heels of IGN and Ubisoft confirming that more people are playing Rainbow Six Siege than at launch, and that's huge.
Yeah.
I think one of my buddies was saying the other night that somebody had a report of over 1 million players on Steam alone. I don't even own the game in Steam. I own it straight through Ubisoft. It was part of the deal with my graphics card. So that's not even tracking what's actually in Ubisoft directly, which I don't know that they released those numbers either. But they'd be more accurate because Steam launches Ubisoft and then Ubisoft launches the game, so the Ubisoft launcher. Yeah. So but yeah, it's a huge claim, and I'm actually hoping that it'll be worthy opponents instead of cheaters. So
yeah, you know, and like I said, as long as there's a fair system where people can dispute it if need be, then I'm totally for that. But yeah, don't cheat, guys. You know, I admitted to cheating on StarCraft, but guess what? It was a solo game, and I just really wanted to get through the story. I had fun playing the game, but I was that invested in the story. I wanted to see what happened. You know, so anytime I went multiplayer on that game, I got demolished very quickly. So I learned very quick that you either had to get good or not play it, and I just didn't play it. So I don't have anything else, I don't think.
Yeah, that's all I've got on that. It was a huge deal because I've talked about Rainbow Six a lot. If this is, you know, if this is true, I mean, then you're looking at the age-old adage of get good, scrub. And
well, it's about to become a concrete law now because this is Ubisoft now doing it. You've got Blizzard, EA doing it with Overwatch.
Just Blizzard, EA.
Just Blizzard. I'm sorry. I thought EA bought them out.
EA has always had the heck is that program called? Punk Buster. That's the one they always use.
Okay.
That's been around since Battlefield 2. So they've had the ways to do this kind of stuff. So but yeah, that's a huge step. Ubisoft needed to do it. It makes people like me who are, you know, well, I didn't pay for the game, I bought a video card. But people that actually paid for the game and actually love playing the game and want the competitive edge, which is funny too, because even in their tournaments, they've caught people cheating. It's like, well, you're at a tournament setting. What are you doing cheating anyways? But
yeah.
I guess the guy wasn't that good. So, but it's just, I like an even playing ground. At least now I can go into matches and say, you know what, that guy got me good. Or, hey, his ping is way higher than mine, and he's just got the advantage. But, which they really need to address next. But at least I know I'm playing against somebody that's actually playing me, you know?
Right.
So, but yeah, that's all I've got too. Yeah, don't cheat. And don't try and rush to the end of games. Oh, I hate that so much. There's people that have already reached the center of the galaxy on what's it called? No Man's Sky.
Well, yeah, that's, you know, well, that's a given. Somebody beat the last Pokemon game that came out, Black and White 2, I think. Somebody beat that in like 4 or 5 hours.
Where's the fun in that? You paid money for that. All right, well, that's all we got for you. Thanks for listening, and please leave us feedback on our episodes on iTunes, Google Play Music, and anywhere else you can get our podcast from. And please like, share, and comment, and subscribe on YouTube, where this video will be at.
Yep. You can contact us at ECG_podcast on Twitter, at our Facebook page, www.facebook.com/ECGpodcast, or our email address at ecgpodcast@gmail.com. Also visit us at our webpage, www.stasisgeek.com. That's STASISGEEK.com. Or like Jamie said, post a comment, and we are going to use our eyes to read it and our brains to comprehend it. Maybe.
Yes, sir.
No guarantees on that last part.
All right, we'll be back. It's Sundays. Sunday evening.
It's Sunday.
So we will be back Friday afternoon. Oh, my God.
Come on, Porky Pig.
This week. Until then, stay geeky.